You are listening to the life of Jesus Christ in a year from the visions of Anne Catherine Emmerich from TAM. I'm Father Edward Looney, and each day I'll be reading and offering commentary to guide you through Anne Catherine Emmerich's magnificent mystical revelations. In addition to listening, you can follow along with the four-volume hardcover set of The Life of Jesus Christ and Biblical Revelations available from TAN. Before we get to today's readings, though, let us ask the intercession of our venerable author. O blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich, devout and pious follower of Christ, who patiently endured the frailty of this mortal condition, who humbly received the honorable marks of Christ Jesus on your hands, feet, side, head, and chest, the marks which you are blessed by the Lord to witness for yourself in his own sufferings. We graciously ask for your intercession with God, that we sinners may be forgiven of our sins and be drawn more completely into spiritual communion with Christ, our Lord and our Savior. We ask this in the name of the most holy Lamb of God, and through the intercession of Holy Mary, our Mother. Amen. Today is day number 131. And in this episode, we will continue reading from Volume 2, from the section pertaining to Jesus' teaching mission. Today, we will pick up where we left off in number 18, Jesus in Abila and Gadara. Next morning, after Jesus had again taught and cured the sick in the synagogue, he went with the disciples, the Levites, the Rechabites, and some of the citizens to the western heights of the mountain. There, making a circuit of about an hour, he went through the vineyards giving instructions. On this mountain range, as far as Gadara, were numerous rocky projections like mounds. Some had been raised by nature, others formed by the hand of man, and around them vines were planted, the vine stalks as thick as one's arms. They were planted far apart and threw out their branches to a great distance. The bunches of fruit were often as long as one's arm, while the single grapes were large as plums. The leaves were larger than those of our vines, though small when compared with the fruit. The Levites put many questions to Jesus upon different portions of the Psalms that treated of the Messiah. They said, "Thou art certainly the greatest prophet after the Messiah. Thou canst explain these points to us." Among other things, there were questions of the words, "Dixit Dominus, Domino Meo," and of him, "that with blood besprinkled garments trod the winepress alone," Isaiah 63:3. Jesus explained all to them with its profound signification and applied it to himself during this little instruction that sat around one of the vine hills eating grapes. The Rechabites, however, would not touch the fruit because they were forbidden to drink wine. But Jesus challenged them upon their abstinence and commanded them to eat, saying that if they sinned by so doing, he would take the guilt upon himself. When they brought forward their law as an excuse for not complying, I heard them saying that Jeremias, on the command of God, had once forbidden it, and they had obeyed. But now that Jesus ordered otherwise, they hearkened to his word. Toward evening, they returned to the city and assisted at another entertainment, to which the poor were admitted. Then Jesus taught in the synagogue and afterward went to the house of the Levites, where he passed that night on the roof, under a tent. Attended by the Levites, Jesus went from Abila to Gadara and reached the small Jewish quarter of the city in the evening. It was separate from the larger pagan quarter, which had as many as 4 idolatrous temples. I knew at once that Gadara was a heathen city from seeing the idol of Baal standing under a large tree. Jesus was well received here. There were Pharisees and Sadducees among the inhabitants. Also a Sanhedrin for the country around, although the male Jews of the place numbered from 300 to 400 only. Jesus found some Galilean disciples awaiting him in Gadara. They were Nathanael, Chased, Jonathan, Peter's half-brother, and I think Philip. Jesus put up at the inn outside the Jewish quarter, where already a great number of arbors had been erected for the Feast of Tabernacles. Next morning, when Jesus went to the synagogue to preach, he was met by a great crowd of sick who had assembled outside to wait for him, and also by several raging possessed. The Pharisees and the Sadducees, though apparently well-disposed, wanted to drive these people away. "They should not be so importunate," they said. It was not the time for that. But Jesus very graciously interposed, "Let them remain," he said, "for it was for them that I came." And he cured many of them. The Jewish Sanhedrin of Gadara were meantime deliberating whether or not they should allow Jesus to teach, since so much was said against him. They unanimously resolved to permit him to do so, for they had heard him very well spoken of, especially after the cure of the son of the centurion of Capernaum. The disciples lately arrived spoke to Jesus of another person at Capernaum who greatly needed his assistance. In the synagogue, Jesus taught of Elias, of Achab and Jezebel, and of the idol of Baal erected in Samaria. And speaking of Elias, Jesus said that he had not received bread from ravens, because he had been disobedient. There were also some allusion made to King Balthazar of Babylon, who had desecrated the sacred vessels and had seen the writing on the wall. Jesus taught long and earnestly from Isaiah, most strikingly applying the prophet's words to himself and uttering profound thoughts upon his own approaching passion and victory. He spoke of the winepress, of the red bloody garments, of the lonely worker, of the nations trodden down its wrath. He had previously spoken of the rebuilding of Zion, of the watchmen upon the walls of the holy city, and I felt that he was alluding to the church. To me, his teaching, though so profound and earnest, was so clear, and yet the Jewish doctors, though surprised and deeply affected, failed to understand him. That night they met together, consulted the scriptures, weighed and compared various passages. They thought that he must surely be allied to some neighboring nation and that he would soon return with a powerful army and conquer Judea. The idol Baal, and under a wine-spreading tree outside the entrance of the pagan quarter, was of metal. It had a broad head and an immense mouth. The head went up in a point like a sugar loaf, and around it was a wreath of leaves like a crown. The idol, short, broad, and chunky, looked like an ox sitting upright. In one hand, it held a bunch of corn, and in the other, some kind of plant. Perhaps grapes or something similar. There were seven openings in its body, and it sat in a kind of cauldron in which a fire could be lighted under it. On its feast, the idol was clothed. Gadara was a stronghold. The pagan quarter was tolerably large and somewhat sheltered by the highest peak of the mountain, at whose northern base were warm baths and beautiful buildings. On the following morning, as Jesus was curing numbers of sick outside the city, the priests approached to salute him. "Why," said he, addressing them, "why were ye so disturbed last night over my teaching of yesterday? Why should ye tremble before an army, since God protects the just? Fulfill the law and the prophets. Why then should ye fear?" Jesus again taught in the synagogue, as on the preceding day. Toward noon, a pagan woman timidly approached the disciples and implored them to bring Jesus to her house, that he might cure her child. Jesus went with several of his disciples into the pagan quarter. The woman's husband met him at the gate and led him into the house. The wife cast herself at Jesus' feet, saying, "Master, I have heard of thy wonders, and that thou canst perform greater prodigies than Elias. Behold, my only boy is dying, and our wise lady cannot help him. Do thou have pity on us?" The boy, about 3 years old, lay in a little crib in the corner. The evening before, the father had taken the child into the vineyard, and he had eaten a few grapes. Soon after, the boy became sick, and the father had to take him back home, whimpering loudly. The mother had held him all night in her arms, vainly trying to relieve him. He already wore the appearance of death. Indeed, he looked as if he might really be dead. At this point, the mother had hastened to the Jewish quarter to implore Jesus' aid for the heathens, had heard of the cures wrought by him on the day before. Jesus said to her, "Leave me alone with the child and send to me two of my disciples." Then came Judas Barsabbas and Nathanael the bridegroom. Jesus took the boy from his crib into his arms, laid him on his breast to breast, pressed him to himself, bowed his face upon the face of the child, and breathed upon him. The child opened his eyes and rose up. Then Jesus held him out in his arms and commanded the two disciples to lay their hands upon the child's head and to bless him. They obeyed, and the child was cured. Jesus then took them to the anxiously waiting parents, who, embracing the child, cast themselves down at Jesus' feet. The mother cried out, "Great is the God of Israel! He is far above all the gods! My husband has already told me that, and henceforth I will serve no other god." A crowd soon gathered, and several other children were brought to the Lord. He cured one little boy of a year old by the imposition of hands. Another of 7 years was a simpleton and subject to convulsions and arising from the possession by the evil one. The child did not endure any violent assaults, but he was often paralyzed and speechless. Jesus blessed him and ordered him a bath of three different waters, some from the warm spring of Amathus, north of the base of the mountain of Gadara, some from the brook Kareth near Abila, and lastly some from the river Jordan. The Jews of these parts kept on hand some of the water of the Jordan, taken from the point over which Elias had crossed. They preserved it in leathern bottles and used it in cases of leprosy. The pagan mothers complained of the frequent illness of their children and of the little assistance they derived from their priestesses in such trials. Jesus commanded the priestesses to be summoned before him. She obeyed reluctantly, for she did not want to enter Jesus' presence. She was closely enveloped in veils. Jesus ordered her to draw near, but she would not look at him. She turned away her face away and behaved exactly like the possessed. She was irresistibly forced to turn away from the glance of Jesus, though at his command she approached Jesus, addressing the pagan men and women before him, said, "I will show you now what wisdom you reverence in this woman and what is her skill." And he commanded the spirits to leave her. Thereupon a black vapor issued from her and all kinds of figures, noxious insects, snakes, toads, rats, dragons, withdrew from her like shadows. It was a horrible sight. Jesus exclaimed, "Behold, what doctrine ye follow." The woman fell upon her knees, weeping and sobbing. She was now quite changed, quite tractable, and Jesus ordered her to disclose by what means she had tried to cure the children. With many tears and half reluctantly, she obeyed. She told that she had been taught to make the children sick by charms and witchcraft, that she might afterward cure them for the horror of the gods. Jesus then commanded her to accompany him and the disciples to where the god Moloch was kept. And he directed several of the pagan priests to be called. A crowd had gathered, for the news of the child's cure was soon spread. The place to which Jesus now went was not a temple, but a hill surrounded by tombs. The god was in a subterranean vault in the midst of them. The vault was closed on top by a cover. Jesus told the pagan priests to call forth their god. When, by means of machinery, they had caused the idol to rise into sight, Jesus expressed to them his regret that they had a god that was unable to help himself. Then, turning to the priestess, he commanded her to rehearse the praises of her god. Tell how she served him and what reward he gave her. Like Balaam, the prophet, the woman began to repeat aloud before all the people the horrors of Moloch's worship and the wonders of the God of Israel. Jesus then directed the disciples to upset the idol and to shake it violently. They did as commanded. Jesus said to the pagans, "Behold the God that ye serve, behold the spirits that ye adore." And in the sight of all present, there appeared all kinds of diabolical figures issuing from the idol. They trembled convulsively, crept around for a while, and vanished into the earth among the tombs. The idolaters gazed at the scene in affright and confusion. Jesus said, "If we cast your God down again into his den, he will surely go to pieces." The priests implored Jesus not to destroy their idol, whereupon he allowed them to raise it as before and lower it into its place. Most of the idolaters were deeply touched and ashamed, especially the priests, although some were very indignant. The people were, however, on Jesus' side. He gave them a beautiful instruction, and many were converted. Moloch was seated like an ox on his hind legs, his forepaws stretched out like arms of one who is going to receive something upon them. But by means of machinery, he could be made to draw them in. His gaping mouth disclosed an enormous throat, and on his forehead was one crooked horn. He was seated in a large basin. Around the body were several projections, like outside pockets. On festival days, long straps were hung around his neck. In the basin under him, fire was made when sacrifices were to be offered. Around the rim of the basin, numbers of lamps were kept constantly burning before the god. Once upon a time, it was customary to sacrifice children to him, but now they dare no longer to do so, and animals of all kinds were offered in their stead. They were consumed in the openings of his body or cast into his yawning jaws. The sacrifice most agreeable to him was an Angora goat. There is also a machine by which the priests and others could descend to the idol in the subterranean vault among the tombs. The worship of Moloch was, however, no longer in great repute. He was invoked chiefly for purposely of sorcery, and especially by mothers of sick children. Each pocket around his person was consecrated to special sacrifices. Children used to be laid on his arms and consumed by the fire under him and in him, for he was hollow. He drew his arms, and when the victim was despoiled upon them, and pressed it tightly, that its screams might not be heard. There was machinery in the hind legs by which he could be made to rise. He was surrounded with rays. This brings us to the end of our reading today, and now we reflect on what we have just listened to, what we have just read. What an incredible reading we had today. So much in this reading. First of which, the cure of that boy who ate the grapes. Second, this battle, Jesus is beginning between the false gods to say that he is the true God. It was quite an entertaining read. And of course, none of the things we read today are in the Gospels. But this is an added bonus then for our own enrichment as we hear it today. There's a few things that Jesus says. He says, "Let them remain, for it was for them that I came." Don't dismiss them. Don't disperse these people. I've come for them. Jesus is for all people, as long as all the people are open to receiving him. And then it says, they unanimously resolved to permit him to do so, for they had heard him very well spoken of, especially after the cure of the son of the centurion of Capernaum. Lots of people were talking badly about Jesus, but there were good things that were being said. Sometimes you and I, we might have this experience where someone has kind of talked about this individual and made us think poorly of them, and then we meet that person and we're like, I don't know where that person got that. And so we have to be careful. We don't want to be the people speaking badly of Jesus or anyone else, but that we want to be the people that build up. And then Jesus taught long and earnestly from Isaiah, most strikingly applying the prophet's words to himself and uttering profound thoughts upon all of these things. So again, as we hear this, Jesus reflecting on biblical revelation. And then Jesus asks, why should ye tremble before an army, since God protects the just? Why do you fear? Why do you tremble? God is with us. God protects us. He helps us. There's nothing to fear. We need to be reminded of this so often. We have this dying boy, and what a beautiful sight. The parents pleading for the boy, Jesus going to the boy, Jesus restoring life. But it says that Jesus held him out in his arms and commanded the two disciples to lay their hands on him too. And so this is a gesture of the church, that Jesus is healing and the church is there, the apostles, and they lay hands also. Jesus is giving a model for future healings and so forth. And then there's these priestesses. Jesus wants to rebuke them, tell them, you're worshiping a false god. They're so turned off by Jesus because what's in them is evil and is repulsed by the very presence of God. But Jesus casts out those evil spirits within them. They begin to praise the God of Israel. He challenges their God. When by means of machinery they had caused the idol to rise in his sight, Jesus expressed to them his regret that they had a God that was unable to help himself. As we were listening to this, as we were reading this, well, obviously what should come to mind is the challenge to the prophets of Baal and how, call down upon your God. And this is what they were doing. And here, and So it's what happened in the Old Testament now occurring in the life of Jesus, and how Jesus wants to bring about right religion and right worship. He wants people to come to know the truth and who the God of Israel is, and specifically who he is. That's why he's applying the words of Isaiah, as we heard a few moments ago, to himself, so that they might know that I am the real deal. I am the one you have been waiting for. He's the God who cares about us. He's the God before whom we don't have to tremble or fear. He's the one that will come to our aid when we call upon him. This brings us to the end of our reading and reflection for today. Please be sure to subscribe to the podcast and sign up for email notifications at emmerichpodcast.com and use coupon code ACE25 for 25% off your next order at tanbooks.com. I hope you'll join us next time as we continue meditating on the life of Jesus Christ with the help of Blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich. Please share this podcast with others. Rate and review it wherever you listen. Share it on social media, email it to your prayer group, text a link to your friends, and encourage them to, so you can have holy conversations about what we're hearing and reading from Anne Catherine Emmerich. Until then, may God bless you, and Mary pray for you.